Welcome to the Alain Guillot podcast, where we speak about personal development and entrepreneurship. This is episode 134. Today, we have with us Steven Arnott. Now, Steven just published a book called The Snowman's Guide to Personal Finance, a simple approach to managing your money. Now, this is an easy-to-read book about how Canadians can take control of their investments and their future. Let's listen to the conversation. Steven, thank you so much for joining me.
Elaine, thank you very much for having me on the show.
So, Steven, I got in touch with you because you just published a book called The Snowman's Guide to Personal Finance. And I'm a blogger, I'm a podcaster, so I'm always on the lookout for these kind of things. And I was able to check out your book and I thought, man, I have to have this guy in my podcast. So I sent you an email and you say yes. So I'm so super delighted that you are here.
Well, thanks so much. I'm glad you were able to catch the tweet and that you reached out. I'm really able to share my thoughts on the book and was able to check out some of your previous podcasts and really appreciate the work that you do. So excited to be able to chat.
Wow, I find that writing a book is such a huge endeavor, and you never know if people are going to even look at it. You know, it's like a, one of the highest risk activities that a person could do. Of course, you must find it rewarding to write it, even if it was just you and your family. But of course, you hope, in our case, we hope that millions of Canadians will read it because it's valuable information. But, you know, I just have to congratulate you on the courage of writing a book.
Oh, thank you. And you're exactly correct. It's, I think the reason that you write a book needs to be there, and it can't necessarily depend on readership, because people have a lot of great books out there that they can check out, and you know, our lives seem to be getting busier and busier. So for me, it was an opportunity to gather my thoughts, get everything on paper, and share it with people close to me. And the fact that I've been able to share it more broadly now that it's been published is even more exciting.
Okay, so before we go any farther, I would like to ask you a little bit of background information. Who are you? Where do you come from? Why do you fell in love with finance? Because after writing this book, I have to assume you are in love with finance. So yeah, give us a little bit of background information about yourself.
Absolutely. So the two words that I would use to describe myself growing up are math and hockey. So from a very early age, those were my two areas of focus. I learned a ton from mathematics, the idea of breaking down a complicated problem into separate, simpler pieces and using previous solutions in new creative ways. I just really enjoyed that topic. And then for hockey, it was a great opportunity to work with others and learn from others and develop perseverance and a lot of those skill sets. So that was me growing up. And when I went to do my undergrad, I did an undergrad in mathematics because I loved the topic and thought it would be a challenging way to learn more. And while I was doing my undergrad, I started getting really interested in the financial markets. There was something that combined human behavior with mathematics, with an uncertain future, that just created this complex and yet structured environment to work. And so since my undergrad, I've been pursuing was able to earn my CFA charter. I was previously working at BMO in investment management and have recently just finished up a role with RBC Investees working on a robo-advisor to help Canadians invest at a lower cost. And so since undergrad, I've been fascinated and, to your point, have fallen in love with personal finance and am at a stage of my career where I'm just hoping to connect with more Canadians to help provide one-on-one guidance, either through the book or through conversations, in order to help them get the most from their money.
And where in Canada are you from?
I grew up in Kitchener-Waterloo and currently live in Toronto. So I've spent most of my life along the 401. I spent some time in London, Ontario to do my master's program, but otherwise have resided in Kitchener-Waterloo and Toronto.
And also you got your CFA charter, eh? That's amazing.
Yeah, it was something that I wanted to do to both develop my skill set in the space and also as just a personal challenge to be able to progress through the learning and the self-study process.
Well, I have to bow my head to you because I tried twice to do the level one CFA exam and I failed and I gave up. So everyone who has a CFA designation, I say, wow, you know, you got my admiration.
Well, I think as with anything in life, we all have things that we're well suited to. I've been fortunate that I test very well, if you will. I'm able to study for things that, you know, typically come across in a structured way on a test, whereas other people are able to do much better in a real life situation where things are a little bit less structured. So I think everyone's wired and has advantages in their own way. So it ends up in this case that it wasn't the right fit for you, but you've started a podcast and I've seen, you know, organized a number of other events that are also quite admirable.
Okay, great. Thank you. You make me feel less bad now. Okay, so you sound like you have a busy life. I mean, you have done masters, you have done CFA, you have a full-time job, you have a life. I assume you have a partner. So where in the hell do you find time to write a book, first of all? And then secondly, I mean, you just told us that you are in love with mathematics, not with English. So it takes some talent to write a book. I mean, you just don't sit down and beautiful prose flows out of your fingers.
Right. In terms of where I find the time, you're absolutely correct that it's tough to balance everything. And for me, I've had an incredibly supportive partner that understands when I spend a weekend writing or is able to, you know, review something that I've written. So for me, it's really about surrounding yourself with people that understand what you're looking to do and are supportive. So I've been fortunate in that respect. In terms of the writing process, you're absolutely correct. And actually, I joke that that was the final stage of writing this book. For the first 6 years of writing it, while doing the CFA, after doing my undergrad, my language was very technical. It was very elaborate. And the final step before I published was to take the readability level from about a grade 12 reading level to a grade 8.5. And that was simply to challenge myself to simplify the language and to get straight to the point. And that learning experience, watching master classes and reading books on writing, it was something that I had never seen myself doing, but I did enjoy quite a bit.
And you say your partner reread your material, and you guys are still friends?
Yes, we're I think more close as a result of this process and supporting each other through it.
I don't know. My best friend, she reads my blog post, and when she gives me her honest opinion, which is the only thing I want, I don't feel so kind towards her anymore.
No, I think it takes strength to provide honest feedback, and to your point, it's what we need. And I think it's a very helpful to have someone in your corner throughout the process.
Okay, so first of all, why do you feel that you needed to write a book? I mean, there are hundreds of books already in personal finance, whether you look at the United States or Canada. So let's start with that. Why do you feel that we needed to have another personal finance book?
So I think each book is able to serve a specific segment of the market. And as I mentioned before, with people reading fewer books and with people being stretched for time, I wanted to write a book that could serve a very specific segment of the world and do so in as effective a way as possible. And so The Snowman's Guide to Personal Finance is specifically targeted for Canadians. So it uses Canadian taxes and Canadian savings accounts and unique characteristics and considerations for the Canadian marketplace. Some of the most popular books today are usually referencing US. And
right,
while you can make transfers from a retirement account there, similar to a retirement account here, if you're going to go through the process of reading a book, you likely want it to be in a language that you can understand and immediately apply. So that was one key focus. And then the second piece was I wanted something that was as simple to understand and as foundational as possible. And so the book starts by introducing the idea of interest. So it makes no assumption about any prior understanding. And the language is in such a way that it can be read by anyone, you know, over the age of 14 who's looking to get a better sense of their money. And so it's an introduction for Canadians, and that's its purpose. And so while there have been a number of those over time, I think this one serves as a very specific, comprehensive, and yet simple look at money for Canadians.
Okay. We already know it's a personal finance book, but if I push you a little bit more, can you describe the content of the book?
Certainly. So the book is split up into three primary sections. The first five chapters outlines the basics of saving and investing. So that's the idea that we all need to save some of our money for the future, because eventually we're not going to work and we'll need money to be able to spend in retirement. So that uses the foundation of building a snowman. So it draws, there's over 20 analogies throughout the book that draw similarities between managing money and building a snowman. So the first five chapters are about saving and investing. Then the second section is about the accessories. So these are things like the top hat and the button nose and the scarf that you would add to a snowman. In this case, it's things that you would add to your personal finance financial plan. So it is tax-free savings account, registered retirement savings plan, budgeting, managing your credit. So the intention is that it truly is a comprehensive look at, there are 12 chapters in section two that outline a broad range of personal finance topics that you would add to the base of saving and investing for the future. And then the final section is about where to go next. So it talks about how to keep yourself organized, resources that you can use, and behavioral considerations to keep in mind as you move forward. So it talks a bit about your psychology and why we have such a hard time managing money. And then it ends with a call to action to help others around you. And so it starts with the basics and then provides the foundation and then tells you where to go next.
And how about the analogy of the snowman? Where does that come from?
So the first analogy started at a dinner with my younger brother and a close friend of ours. And my younger brother had saved up a sizable amount of money from summer jobs and wasn't investing it. It was actually in his checking account. And so he wasn't earning interest on his savings. And so when I was trying to describe the importance of investing for the future, I said that his money sitting in a checking account was similar to water sitting in a bucket out in the sun, gradually evaporating away. So with a bucket of water, you can't see anything happening from minute to minute, but if you leave it out in the sun long enough, it'll be gone. And so that same idea can be applied to your savings, and through inflation, through things getting more and more expensive over time, $10,000 today in 20 years might get you $5,000 worth of goods. And so it's just the importance of investing for the future and putting your money to work. And then that analogy gradually snowballed into more than 20 other topics where I was able to find similar ways to build a snowman and manage your money. And so the idea of the analogy is to provide a simple way to visualize and understand a topic and a more memorable way to recall it and explain it to other people in the future.
Wow. Okay, I don't know about you, but as you know, I write a blog and I have this podcast where I speak a lot about personal finance. And when I speak to people outside on the streets, I get two reactions. About 80% of them just want to escape the conversation as soon as it's politely possible. So I get like the eyes rolling and, you know, like change the subject fast. And then that's about 80%. And then another 20%, as soon as I mention investing, they go, oh, yes, well, tell me about cryptocurrency. Tell me about options. Tell me about Tesla. Tell me about the latest marijuana stock. So there is very little of tell me of actionable, reasonable things that I can do. I wonder, what is it like for you when you speak about personal finance to the people around you?
So I recognize that I'm in a bit of a bubble. The people that I've surrounded myself with, they also are interested in personal finance. And so I won't mention people immediately around me, but exactly to your point, when I talk with people either related to my roles or if I ever bring it up to, you know, friends of friends, you're exactly right that there's that tendency to pull away or to remove themselves from the conversation. Either it's a lack of interest or a lack of understanding that creates this withdrawal from the conversation. And then on the other side, I find a lot of the people that are brought into the conversation and understand a topic, it's likely because they've been caught by a catchy headline. And so that is usually, you know, real estate boom or the marijuana stocks or crypto. There seems to be, in today's day, a very newsworthy need in order to get our attention. And so very few people are seeing an article about a balanced portfolio and clicking on it and thinking, this is what I need in my life right now. Right. But a lot more people will see, you know, a 100% return or a 10,000% return in the case of cryptocurrencies. And that's what will get their attention. And that's what's in the media. And so I think that's what causes that difference between you're either not interested and not exposed, or the things that you are interested to aren't necessarily the right things to be spending your time on.
Right. And I know you are doing your part. I mean, you spent already a few years writing this book, and I saw your blog as well. So you keep trying to bring your information down to the public. But I mean, and of course, I don't think you have the answer, but how could we get more people interested in personal finance? I mean, people are suffering. People have so much debt, student debt, regular credit card debts, and zero savings. I mean, I know so many people who are in their 50s and they have nothing. They just are counting with the generosity of the government. They believe that the government is going to reach out to them at age 65 and supply them with the same lifestyle that they are having right now. So yeah, how could we get more people interested in this subject?
It's a terrific question, and the one that I think about the most often. There's been a few other personal finance bloggers and people on Twitter talking recently about the importance of going to the consumer. For a lot of history, you know, personal finance advocates have kind of not preached, but have spread their message from where they are and expected people to come to them. And I think that what we need to do is find ways to go to people and make personal finance relevant. And as an example of that, I was recently able to do a guest blog post for Boomer and Echo, which is a major Canadian personal finance blog. And the idea is that personal finance can be compared to a side hustle. And so I call it becoming the CFO of your finances. And so you can earn anywhere from $50 to $150 an hour by doing small tasks related to your money. And so where there might be a ton of people Googling for side hustles, lucrative side hustles, fewer are Googling for, you know, how to budget, how to save money. But they can get you to the same place. And so I've been trying to find ways to make personal finance relevant and bring it to audiences rather than expecting them to source it out themselves.
Wow. Another thing that I see in the marketplace is, okay, so someone finally decides to look up personal finance in the internet. Maybe they decide to start a savings account or investment account. And what do? They Google, where to invest my money. And what do you see? A whole bunch of advertisement of financial service that sounds, have this catchy phrase, and people finally go in there, and there is this slick salesman or saleswoman who offers a pamphlet of all kind of high fee investments. And of course, a person who doesn't know any better goes ahead, and I mean, it's better than nothing, but I feel like for many people, the first step is that they get into high cost financial products.
I agree, and the challenge the way that it's been presented to me in articles that I've read is the idea of just-in-time financial literacy. So financial literacy has been challenged as of late through research that suggests a year after you learn something, you forget it. And so, you know, a book like mine, where it's teaching you common concepts and ideas, it's helpful. But if you don't use those ideas, then when you go and do search about investments, you might get into that funnel of high cost product sales. So the best combination is to combine a high level financial literacy, so that you have a general sense of what's out there. But then each time that you go to make a purchase or do a financial transaction, source out independent content and learn more about it before you make a decision. And so that combination of, you know, exposure to topics ahead of time so that you know what's out there and you know the importance of learning more once you're ready, combined with, you know, once you're ready, go and learn a bit more about each topic, that I think is the right combination in order to minimize the number of people that are getting pressured into high cost funds or high cost products, or, you know, even products that aren't right for their situation.
Right. I'm going to give you an example of this happened to a friend of mine, and I hope he listens to this episode, although I don't think he will. So he sees an advertisement, something that goes like, we will take care of your future, we, you know, we hold your hands, and blah, blah, blah. So he went to this meeting where it was in a restaurant. They serving a beautiful steak. This, my friend, is a meat eater and beer and alcohol. So he invested, he let this institution manage all his money. And of course, I saw his statement, and all the mutual funds that he got, all of them have expense ratio of over about 3%, plus some other service fees. So I continued telling him, you know how much money you pay for that steak or for that beer? It's just incredible. Yeah, but you know, it just takes some time. Now, after a few years of me telling him, look, this is how much this steak is still costing you, he finally is coming around to start educating himself to look for other investment alternatives.
It's a very tricky situation as we look at some of the newer entrants into the investment management space, like Wealthsimple and other robo-advisors. They're finding that their cost of acquisition is significant. I think I saw numbers of $1,000 to acquire a client, and that's because we, as the general Canadian populace, we just don't know enough about these topics where they can come in and say, hey, you're paying too much for your situation. Here's a product that might work for you. And so they're having to do a lot of that groundwork and educate people on the differences between high cost and low cost investing and when one is right. And so it's very challenging for them to do that work. And so I think it's on us as a personal finance community to continue to lay that groundwork and inform people about their options and inform people about the damages of fees over long periods of time. So you're doing your friend a service, and I think the challenge is that not everyone has that friend who either knows or is comfortable speaking out, sharing with them. And so I think that's another thing that I'd like to support or ask people to do, is if you see other friends and family that are in a situation that isn't ideal or that you can help them with, you know, you don't have to speak to the topic, but point them in the direction of a resource or a trusted source for learning more.
Wow. Okay, Stephen, I read the book. I liked it very much. I wonder what's next for you in your career. Now you are an author. You have a job in finance, I guess. You know, they say that writing books is almost like a drug addiction. Once you do one, you have to do another one. So maybe there will be another one in your future. But right now, what else is going on in your career?
So right now, I'm looking to transition into a financial planning role. It's nice. Something that I've wanted to do for the last 7 years since I, you know, got into the personal finance space. I used to be a math tutor, and I love working one-on-one with people, or, you know, helping couples and just explaining complex topics in easy to understand ways. And so that's something that I'm working on currently, recently enrolled in the CFP program. So looking to continue to improve my understanding of the financial planning space. And that'll be something that I'm looking at over the next 6 to 12 months. On top of that, exactly to your point with the book, I'd love to continue writing and covering additional topics in a simple and digestible way. So if there's interest in the book and, you know, I'm able to continue to do that, it's something I'd love to do.
Okay. And the final question is, how can people find out where to get the book or your blog, where to follow you and see what are you up to?
Absolutely. The book's currently available online through Amazon or through Indigo. So you can get the print or ebook version through either of those channels. In terms of the blog, I'm at snowmansguide.com, and you can follow me on Twitter, snowmans_guide, and I'll share new posts and new ideas. If I'm doing events or visiting areas, I'll be sharing it all there as well.
And is there anything I neglected to ask you, maybe something you were hoping that I asked you and I didn't?
No, I think the one thing that I would ask your audience is, you know, being plugged into the personal finance community and listening to this podcast, you're in a position where you can help others. And so if it's sharing this podcast or sharing the book, you know, it's very difficult to reach people through traditional communications. You know, we're closed off to a lot of the noise that we see in our day-to-day lives. And a recommendation from a friend or family member can really make all the difference in helping to point someone in the right direction. So if you can share it, you'll be doing people a great service.
Yeah, we don't have the big budget of a credit card company.
So right, exactly.
Word of mouth is the only tool that we can use. Stephen, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much for having me, Elaine.
And that's it. I don't have much to add to this conversation. If you have a minute, please go over to Stephen's website, check it out. He's got a nice blog. And also, please check out his book and say hello to him. He's in LinkedIn. Tell him that you listen to him in this podcast. And well, moving on, let me ask you, in this time of COVID-19, what are you doing different with your life? Do you have the time to reflect, or are you with your kids at home trying to keep everything together? I find myself with a lot of time for inner reflection and how I can improve my life. And I hope you had that time too. We have less noise now because we are not exposed to advertisement, to the outside world, to the pressures of society. And I find personally that I have time and the space to look inward and decide what is it that I want to continue doing with my future, and how am I living my life the way that I would like to live it. And I'm putting this out there because I'm wondering if you're asking yourself the same question. Are you living your life the life that you would like to be living it? Are you happy? Are you satisfied? Or maybe, are you going to take this time to reflect and see if you would like to make some changes? Let me know in the comments. And that's it. Please connect with me via LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram. I'm in all those platforms. And I'll be happy to hear your thoughts. How are you surviving? Are you looking inside? Are you just trying to make it day by day? Yeah, I would like to know what's going on with you. So, until soon, guys. Thank you so much for listening. Goodbye.